Going to get started now. My name is Amy Coral. I'm the Curator of Education and Public Engagement here at MOCAD, and it is my pleasure to welcome you today for this conversation with Tal R and Terry Myers. This talk is being held in association with Tal's exhibition, which opened last night, good party, and which will be on view in our Woodward Gallery until July 29th. We are honored today to have Ambassador Ann Riggleson with us. She is here from New York, where she has served as Consul General of Denmark since 2015. Prior to that, she was Denmark's Ambassador to France and has served as the Head of Administration and Services Secretariat in the Minister of Foreign Affairs, in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. This is quite a title here. Under the Undersecretary for European Affairs, and she was the first secretary at the Permanent Mission of Denmark to the United Nations. She also happens to be a fan of Tal R, and she is here today to introduce him. Please join me in welcoming Ambassador Riggleson.
Thank you very much for this introduction, which was wonderfully old school, with all those weird titles that don't mean that much. A great, great thank you to MOCAD. A great thank you to the director of MOCAD and its board for being so, for having such an impeccable taste to choose Tal R for this exhibition. This is, of course, a gift to a diplomat like me. I didn't have to do any work. One of the best Danish artists was chosen by you to come here, and I saw opportunity. So here I came afterwards. And I came not only to say thank you to MOCAD and Detroit, and Tal R, of course, but also to tell you that after you made that decision to integrate Tal R in the work you are doing here at this great museum, Denmark, and it was totally unrelated, decided that we would like to understand this great country better. We have decided for the next 3 to 4 years to focus on a number of cities with whatever we can bring from our side, it being in the cultural sphere, in the sphere of design and architecture, to develop our relationships, because this world is getting more and more complicated to understand. And without understanding it and fighting for the same causes, identifying them and fighting it, it perhaps may not even have a chance. We thought, being a small country, that the right match for us was cities. And of course, when we had to choose cities, the most interesting, the most vital, the most charming cities, and what came up as the first on that list, chosen by artists and designers in Denmark, Detroit. So you will see a lot of us, sorry about that, a lot of us in the next 3 years, and hopefully in the period afterwards, because nothing is really interesting if it's a one-off. That was the boring part. The more interesting part is to introduce Tal R and the talk that you will have afterwards with and about him. It took God 6 days to create the world, this world, our world. And Tal is a fantastic runner-up. It took him 7 days to create what you have in here. It's an amazing feat. Not only that he created such pieces of art within that limited time frame, but also that he had the courage to do it not knowing whether it would be successful or not, and doing it here, sur place, in Detroit, and in that way trying to integrate himself as much as he could or not. Because the interesting part, the fascinating part of the way Tal is working is that he very consciously shows you that what he's doing is his imaginations of what's happening. And that creates a space for us to project our ideas and fantasies into that space. Those ideas may be the same, it may be not. When I saw the exhibition, and Tal was telling me all the time, but it's your projections, Anne, I saw, which perhaps some of you did, lots of Chagall, lots of Klee, lots of Picasso. I also saw ominous destinations for trains like Auschwitz, but that's coming from a European point of view. You seeing trains, you seeing the color of blue, you seeing horses and cats turned upside down, you seeing languages that we may or may not understand have other projections. And those projections and what that start is, that is the start of the conversation that Tal would like and that nobody can do better. You know he is a rock star in Denmark and all of Europe, and I'm sure a rock star or a techno star here in Detroit, he will be already. And he will be perhaps, especially if you hear him yourself, with Terry Myers, who knows everything about Tal R and Denmark and the art scene there. So it's time for me to say, now you will hear it from the horse's mouth. And a blue horse is really a very, very sure source of information. No fake news here. You will hear it from the heroes themselves. Thank you very much.
Wow, to follow that. Tal and I have no plan. I will say, those of you who don't know me, I'm just finished, as of yesterday, 5 years of being the chair of painting and drawing at the School of Art Institute of Chicago. I've been a published art critic since 1988, and I've known Tal since 1997, when in the 90s I was doing a lot of work in Denmark, living in Los Angeles at that time. And Tal was in an exhibition at the Louisiana Museum called the Louisiana Exhibition. And that's where I was first introduced to the work and to him. And then I taught for 2 days at the Royal Academy there and didn't find out till, it was more than a year. You know, I found out much later that Tal was still a student at the Academy. We're only 2 years apart, but he was still a student. And he didn't engage me at school at all, which I now take as a sign of health and well-being and you know, that he was already showing. So I don't really want to rehash all of that. I have an interview with Tal in the Academy of Tal R book, the big show that was at Louisiana. I really want to focus on this with you. But we don't have a big plan. But I'm particularly, where I want to start is the underlying premise of doing this about neighborhoods that you, this idea of not knowing and then creating imagery or bringing sort of your way of working, your way of being into creating this kind of exchange, let's say, with the sense of community, with the kind of place that you probably now know a little more, having been here wandering around, than you did when you first started this project. Like, what is it, what did it, why the idea to like do, to have this idea, well, I don't know Detroit, but I'm gonna pick neighborhoods, I'm going to, you know, sort of use this idea of place.
Actually, that's always the premises for a painting. If you go to the Dia Foundation here, not the Dia Museum here, sorry, and you see a still life, flowers on the table, you understand that that moment happened somewhere long ago. And there is this kind of gap between you and the painting. If there would be a text underneath this still life that explained that was 4 o'clock afternoon somewhere in Paris, what happened that day, where did the person buy the flowers, then you would have all the information. But actually most art is enjoyed with a gap, with kind of a weird distance. So I'm actually just trying to make myself more interesting than I actually am. I'm just doing what people actually have always done. That's kind of throw something out that the people that you can touch, you can talk about. If I paint a train, a horse, a fat cat upside down, then you can start having your own conversation. This has always been going on. The only little difference I did here is I also put a name from a neighborhood that I didn't know anything about. That means that I throw even more out for the audience, something that they feel quite intimate and comfortable about. So there is a fat cat and there is a name of a neighborhood. Those are the things that are there to play with. What does it mean to play? I think I've mentioned this a few times, that I like to think of it that you put a stone in somebody's shoe. You go in and you walk around, you look at this exhibition, and you might walk out saying, I don't like this, or I like this. It's no real big difference. As long as you leave with a stone in your shoe, something that is a little, almost it's close to playing with conspiracy, that you're kind of saying something. You're kind of saying, this is a train, and you even direct the train in a certain direction, or this is a horse, and this clown sitting on the horse has no arms. You're kind of doing something that in a normal social context is quite rude. You're saying something, you're pulling back. You're saying something, you're pulling back. Why is the artist doing something like that? It's simply the artist wants the work to be placed in your brain. It is done for you, it's not for me. I could be in my room. So you do all these different things to place stone in people's shoes. That was a long answer, I'm sorry. And I forgot to say two things. Thank you for coming. This is really bad weather. This is like where I come from. This is like Danish weather, I don't know. It's like the weather is following us here, I'm sorry about that. The next thing, I have to correct the ambassador. Terry is not the one that knows the most about me. This is Linda, who made a dinner for us the other day. It's a beautiful woman, I think she is close to 80, but to be polite, let's say I think she's 75. She came up to me, she said, your painting is in my bedroom, so you know everything about me.
I don't know everything about Tal, but I know a few things. Some things he doesn't even know I know, but... the stone in the shoe, yes, I've heard that, and that Tal, I mean, you know, the one of the, having known Tal and his work as long as, when you know, for someone like me, when you know an artist and know their work for decades, you see it a lot, you really experience it, and you start doing what I do for a living, you start not listening to the artist so much, you know, that the work has a life of its own. That the work sort of does all these things that a good artist, a great artist, often has no clue that these things are happening in the work. So one thing that struck me last night, and because you know I knew about this sort of risk that Tal was putting forward. I'm going to come. I'm going to make these big things. You know, I don't know if I can do it. You know, that this is a Tal has this in him. He's done this. This is a way of working for him, of like, you know, courting disaster, let's say. And I think great artists do that. And I do believe, Tal, is a great artist. And I don't say that word very often. But I do think that there's something about what this work actually is and what it is physically and what it is in this space that is really quite profound in the larger context of different things you've done. Like, I did see the show in Denmark, the big sort of survey show. But there's, I said to someone last night, what I love about the paintings is somehow they fit because they don't fit. You know, there's something about them being too big for the lights and too big for everything about them. They really don't fit, but that's what makes them fit all the way more. So one of the reasons I think it does that is because just in pure, like, painting terms, and you've also, in the interview we did before, you talked about how really, you know, painters really have to bring it back to painting. All the other stuff has to disappear, that the painting itself becomes, you know, the be-all, end-all, and this notion of, like, giving people the ability to stand in front of them, and you've made these juxtapositions of, like, an image with a neighborhood you didn't know as a kind of clue of, like, you can have your way with this. But with that said, the paintings themselves are doing very particular things as paintings that maybe don't necessarily allow us to just have, you know, our total way with them. That they're in a space, in a kind of dialogue, that they're in a situation of this kind of environment that I think is meaningful back to this notion of what neighborhood even means. I mean, I did some homework to look up all the different neighborhoods you've chosen, their histories in that, and, you know, they're probably better experts than me here about that. But there are all these things that connect that are total accidents, I'm sure. But that, to me, reinforces back to your idea about the still life. There are things that happen in that still life painting, even if you know all the time and date and the details, that are meaningful, but there are no reason for them. So all the things that were intentional, then creating this space of all these things that are now just happening here, independent of you. That's a lot. I apologize.
No. I really enjoyed what you said a little bit earlier, that over the years you stopped listening to the artist. I mean, that might sound rude, but I think you are in the right direction. You have to understand that, first of all, English is not my first language, but speaking about my work is also not my first language. Doing a room like this is number one. And there is a great mistake you can make, and that could be close to what you said, listening to the artist, is that I'm not as clever as my work. That means even some of the things that I do is a mystery for me. Some artists, if you hear artists explaining their work like they are the puppet master, like everything means something, and I did this because of that, and you can see they're totally in control, you can be sure that's quite stupid art. No, because in a way, you create a method that work unfolds in a more clever way than the artist. So if some of these things are a mystery for me, then it might also be a mystery for you. What does it mean, mystery? You can also say it less romantic. You can also say intelligence. Say that the work is clever. And somehow it has some level that is, that you cannot, you're really reaching, you cannot really completely grab it like this. That could also be a level of intelligence in the work. But to be able to create work like that, the artist should stop being like a puppet master. You have to kind of don't know how to say it, let the work unfold. There are so many ways to say it, lose control, but I don't like that idea.
And that's not accurate.
It's not accurate. It's, even intuition is not accurate, because it all ends up in a hippie commune in California. And we don't want this conversation to be there, but somehow the work has to unfold itself. And even I have to step back, and I have to say, I can pretend if I get embarrassed here that I know everything about my own work, but I will have to tell you that it's pretentious. There's stuff that I also don't know. Maybe you know, but I don't know.
Yeah, well, I'm gonna indulge myself for a second. Tal hasn't heard this yet. I want to read you something that I wrote.
Oh.
Because this isn't long. All of his paintings depict, no matter how abstractly, but never non-objectively, people, places, and things, so much so that it would be possible to categorize everything quite efficiently using those three terms and leave it at that. What makes his work beguiling is the extent to which each of these categories, or for that matter, any category, is reworked within the varied yet interrelated states of his painting. For example, a painting as a person, even if abstract, with a personality and an attitude. Another painting as a place, a construction site of tangible material, including collage, photography, graphics, sculpture, etc. And then yet another painting as a thing, in the obvious sense, but also as a kind of creature, sometimes even a monster, or as a kind of building or scaffolding, a thing to put other things in and on. Things that are also places. So that the shorthand of that is that every painting you make is a place, sometimes literally in terms of the paint deposited, scaffolding to put something in, that if your painting makes you think of a person, it's a person as a place. If the painting is a thing, it's a thing as a place. This idea of place, place, place. So then to turn to Detroit as a place, pick these neighborhoods, I think is a quite provocative next move for you. Not that you've done Live at Club Zombie, you've articulated places in your work before. One of my favorite paintings of yours, you know this already, is this painting called The Japan from 2009, which to me is the quintessential Tal R articulating this kind of idea of painting as a place. I mean, physically a place. And it resonates for me because another personal thing here is that I don't know Detroit very well, but I was born and raised in Fort Wayne, Indiana, which is called Little Detroit, is one of its nicknames. You know, Wayne County, we both shared General Matt Anthony Wayne as our namesake I grew up, my father ran a lathe at Zollner Pistons, which is why the Detroit Pistons are called the Detroit Pistons, because they used to be the Zollner Pistons basketball team. So living in Fort Wayne, I feel I kind of know Detroit. I used to teach with Mike Kelly, and I was like, Mike, I know you, like, we grew up, I wasn't Catholic, but this idea of what Detroit represents is something you didn't have the full information for, but you're so attuned at place and how painting functions at place that you've actually done something that I'm convinced you don't even realize you've done in terms of what is potentially resonating with these paintings. And I'm gonna ask Alicia and everyone, I'd be really curious like how the show is received, how people who, you know, there might be people walking into the here that really know this city backwards and forwards and know the history, know like all those battles with Indians. And you know, Fort Wayne that's here is much younger than the Fort Wayne that started in 17 whatever in the city I'm from. We actually have a fake fort, old Fort Wayne in downtown Fort Wayne right now. So this idea of like location, and I think, but the question I have, well, maybe react to that first. Do you think I'm on to something? You're just a sort of placemaker, like a placeholder? You're just doing your job? You're just sort of like, you know, finding a place and making the painting sort of do that? Or am I being too simple? I mean, you use paintings as dumping grounds. You do all this stuff to just like, you know.
You mean like therapy?
Well, no. I mean literal stuff. The material. I'm talking about the painting, painting the paintings, making the paintings. You came here. You were so excited, I think, about coming here to take this risk to make them here.
I think each of us, whether we want it or not, we live in our own brain, our own city brain. You know, the brain as a city. And I also think, you know, a conversation like this is actually not necessary. It's interesting for all of us, but it's not really necessary. You should be able to go in there and that's everything. I should be able to leave. But I could explain you, I think that's also what you're asking for, a little bit about method. Also, when you want to learn from other artists, you very early as an art student find out the biggest mistake is to try to learn from an artist example. That means if you like Philip Guston, then you should not learn from a hand smoking a cigarette, which is a motive from him, or, but you can actually, you have to find a way to step one step further back to understand the method without figures. Just how they do it before they do it. And how I do it before I do it is simply like this, that I work with all these kind of motifs, figures, drawings. Sometimes they lose their vitality, then I put them away. Later they appear again in new forms. So that's like being in my head. When I go to Detroit, I said I cannot just stay in my own head. That will be boring for you and selfish of me. So I try to, how can I connect the horse to Detroit? How can I make it more that it's a place you can walk into? So I think during developing as an artist, you search for a bridge between your brain and other people. Also that it becomes meaningful. When I came here in November, I had a, Alicia knows and the people from here knows, I had a completely different plan. I said, I want to do a show called Snow. And Alicia said, you want to do a show called Snow in May? Yes. Because I want it to be snow in May. Again, something that is off. Something where it's like trying to catch a fish and it just gets out of your hand. Why do you want, you know, if you want to sell something, it shouldn't slip out of your hand. You should catch it and you should feel it's yours. But art is a bit different because the moment you don't really catch it, who do you catch? You're standing there with yourself. And that's in a way productive. That's productive for communicating your ideas. But then I came here, I kind of in a simple way, let's say, smelled the street, the atmosphere, the people, everything here. And I suddenly remember that I once was on a boat in Greenland on a scientific expedition, and I read a book that's the best book I ever read. The book about America by Kafka, and he never came here. And it's simply about a boy that comes on a boat and he gets lost. He ends up, I think, in a circus in Ohio. And I really love this idea about things that you are actually never allowed to do. As an artist, it can be productive to talk about things you don't know. And actually, I made this into my business. I all the time talk about things I don't know, but I'd never talk without throwing something in there. So I wanted to do the same when I came here. I wanted to talk about neighborhoods that I have no clue about. I want to be, I don't know the English word, it's not rude, it's like inappropriate, it's maybe getting close. I wanted to be inappropriate here, to say Del Rey. I don't know, I mean, actually I went to Del Rey because of a friend of mine sent us there. He said, go there, go to Del Rey. And I didn't have it on my list for neighborhoods. And then I thought, the most obvious thing is to do a train for Del Rey neighborhood. But I said, that's not what I'm gonna do. I could either place a fat cat in Del Rey. No, a horse with a weird clown on the back would be perfect because it's like this. I even have to do this with myself. I don't know if I answer anything. I don't know if what I say makes sense.
Well, yeah,
but the main thing I'm saying is, the work of an artist should always be more clever than the artist. If you are doing art, if that's the other way around, you're on the wrong track.
Right.
Any artwork in history that is like so clever, where everything is placed like this and there's an explanation of anything, it's always banality.
I would say, as I get older, I realize that the artist that I had the most connection with, the one big reason I have the connection is because of a kind of level of inappropriateness, or I would say a respect for the unauthorized. And what I mean by that is that that's a kind of unauthorized way of doing things, especially in the kind of academic construct of like how we're supposed to do things. Tal came to the Art Institute, I invited him to the painting department, and one of the themes of his amazing talk there, it's online if you want to watch it, was about being irresponsible. And this is something I believe as well, that being responsible as an artist is the kiss of death. The other thing I always tell students, and they just look at me like I'm so nuts, is like, you're too damn earnest. Earnestness has killed more artwork than anything else in the world. You've got to get over that. But what I want to say is, you bring up Del Rey, and where my brain went, because this is one thing I knew before I did a little research, is that Del Rey is actually where the Fort Wayne of Detroit is in that neighborhood. And, you know, that's all here because of the Mexican-American War originally. So these are all things you had no idea, and maybe people who live in Detroit don't necessarily know the history of what, you know, that, like, and how many of us think about the Mexican-American War from that period in history? I mean, but I grew up in Fort Wayne, being in elementary school, taken to this old fort where these actors are behaving like it's 18 whatever. And I remember being in the fifth grade, and a bunch of us, because I was such a nerd, we had deliberately tried to find out something that had happened the year after to see if we could trick an actor into saying an answer about something. Like, we'd say, no, that didn't happen yet, you know. And then we were driven to Chief Little Turtle's grave, which is one of the Indian chiefs who tried to negotiate with Mad Anthony Wayne. He was called Mad Anthony Wayne because he was nuts. I mean, he was mad. And it didn't go well. And it brutalized murder of indigenous tribes that happened in this part of the world. You know, but this grave, it's like a Tal R. This grave is in between these two, late 19th century homes in downtown Fort Wayne, just in a vacant lot. So there's some family living here in this quite not very well-off neighborhood in Fort Wayne. You know, here's this grave with this one headstone for Chief Little Turtle, and then there's another house. That's like a Tal R painting. That's an idea of place. That's like, it's not, it doesn't belong, it doesn't make sense, but it's right in a way. I mean, I could go on and on about this. I mean, Johnny Appleseed is the other person buried in Fort Wayne. We got driven, Johnny Appleseed. Do you know who Johnny Appleseed was? He was this guy who went around and planted apple trees all over the place, supposedly, and that. So these myths that you grew up in the Midwest, even, and you think about the European, this show is doing all these things. There's no effing way you would know all that. There's no way I would allow you to know all of that, because it would wreck it all. But what you do know, and I guess what I'm really getting to, is what this does now in terms of you demonstrating once again that you goddamn well know how to make a painting. So I want to talk about that, just to come and actually do this here. What's on your mind right now, having accomplished this thing that you were, at the very least, let's say, concerned about? You made them. They're done.
More than a year ago, I started going through what I already have done, looking at different kind of paintings, figures that I've been playing around with, and I start drawing them out of there. I had all these blue notebooks all over my table, maybe 20 of them, full of all these blue drawings, because I was interested in the possibility of going somewhere, bus, train, airplane, just leave and say, I'm here now, I'm gonna do a painting. That means I go and buy some paint. I get a piece of paper or canvas or a wall and I do it. Just very simple. That means pulling out of the studio. I'm actually an artist that's very kind of studio artist. I work in there and I have all my stuff, and all the stuff helps me. All artists know about this, that the studio helps them, but the studio also, in a way, sabotage the artist, because it is really like a comfort zone. So I wanted to try to kind of distance myself a bit, just pull all the possibilities into my head again and just be able to travel. So I didn't know when I arrived here how long time it would take, how could I know, to do 6 quite large paintings. So now I understand it's actually possible. And the way they were done, I think when you're doing something like, when you're playing around with, when you have more time with a painting is always about that you are heading for somewhere. It's never just taking a white canvas and just start, see what happens. I think that's rarely productive. And I also, in the years I've been teaching, always tell the students that's a myth about art. Maybe if you are Jesus or Buddha, you just put something, a white canvas, and you just start. But most of us needs an idea to fail with or to succeed with. And usually an artwork is a mix of both failure and success. so how did I get here now? And how do I get back? So when doing paintings like this, I actually do them, I build them on certain experience that I'm quite sure about. I think musicians who go on tour, they know the same, that this is gonna work. You know this will work. So what I did is I painted the painting in many colors. First, I did very simple drawing. Like, I had an idea, the train, this. I kind of placed the objects in there. And then I painted them in loads of colors, just more color, like heating them up. And then when they were heated up and they look all terrible, you start cleaning them up, calming them down again. And you know, people coming and say, why don't you stop now? You should stop now, they are ready now. Why don't you just leave it? In a way, that's where you have to be a little bit experienced, because you get nervous. You're actually quite nervous when you work like that. You're not very secure about yourself. So people come in and say, leave it now. There was one guy, the guy that works here, that came in and said something great. He said, how come you paint them in all these layers? And I couldn't find the right English word. And he said to me, oh, I understand you want the painting to go woo, 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 woo. And I said, he's absolutely
that's
right.
That's the English word.
See, I don't know the word for that, but when you paint colors underneath and you end up with blue on top, that means the painting is moving a little bit forwards and back. They don't completely settle in the eyes, because you sense all what is under.
Yeah.
I think the, yeah.
No.
Did that mean I have to stop? Okay, I take this.
No, but you just got to where I wanted you to go. Not that I'm trying to direct you anything, but that what's actually in there physically is really the heart of the beast. And I want to read one more thing. And I promise I won't do this again. But another thing, I'd done this whole thing in this text I'm writing about modernist painting, postmodernist painting, post-postmodernist painting, so on and so forth. And then I wrote this. I said, nevertheless, Tal has always resisted such schemes by forcing his work to do something that in words sounds contradictory, to run roughshod over, under, and through the boundaries of painting and art itself nonstop, while reinforcing what has been the focus of four significant painters for a very long time. And then this is a quote from Tal. I think that at the end of the day, the painter doesn't care about the specific face or horse or tree. He just cares more about the painting, which doesn't mean that the subject matter is unimportant. It just means that in the context of the painting, they have to adjust at any price for the painting itself. That's the end of the quote. And then I wrote, that bears repeating. Adjust at any price for the painting itself. So I think that, when you ended by talking about the layer and the colors beneath, that's just something that, like, you are at the service of your work in those situations. Like, the painting is sort of leading you by the nose, saying, like, you have to do this, Tal. Like, this is just something that has to happen materially, physically, layers. Again, to not start from nothing, that you know, at that point you are just like you're the chief worker in the Tal R studio at that point, and that the painting's really the boss, that the people, the place, the horse, whatever it is, they all have to adjust at any price for the painting itself. That's what you always come back to.
It's true.
And so many people don't actually do that. Someone who teaches in art schools and has painters, you would think that that's something that everyone would be committed to. But painting became a place where a lot of people thought, I don't really have to deal with that. You know, I can do all these other things.
I mean, my necessity, what I need when I do the painting and what the painting needs, it sounds maybe more romantic but what does it mean that the painting has needs? Actually, it's much more formal. You look at painting and you keep looking at them and you keep developing your eye for when something is like brilliant. The necessity of the painting is that it wants to be brilliant. That's not always what I want, but I'm actually looking for the painting, if the painting has a possibility to go into the arena of being brilliant. Instead of brilliant, you can say beautiful, but beautiful doesn't mean necessarily beautiful like this. but something that reaches over its own physicality in a way, that it's more, it is this weird physical thing where something is dry, it's not wet anymore, it's just dried, and then it speaks, it actually leaves that. It's a weird thing that it is just exactly that object, but it also points outside. As a viewer, you're deep in that painting, but you also, in a way, pointed somewhere else. I think that's the world of when painting becomes something brilliant.
Yeah. Can I ask you about the newspaper?
Yes.
Because the newspaper is a place where, like, I note the breadboard images.
Yeah.
You know, that's from the studio.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
from. Can you talk a bit
yes,
about the newspaper?
Sure. So two different things. I wanted to practice before coming here. I wanted to kind of make a circle around certain possibilities that I thought could be right for doing the paintings here. So when I was here in November, I picked up all these Detroit newspapers. And every day for a few months, I would put them on the table and look around and see what's possible. What could I imagine possible doing here? And I would paint them on the Detroit newspaper because I knew eventually we would do this newspaper. So in a way, the free newspaper in here is a pool of possibilities that I wanted to bring. We already knew it would be displayed like this. Another thing, usually when you go and see a painting show, and I'm used to it, I live from this, I buy shoes out of this, I buy clothes for my kids out of this, is that when you go in and see a painting show, the object, there are the people, it's free to enjoy it. Everybody can do this everywhere in the world. But then there are some people that can also say, I would like to have it. I take this painting home. This is an object of desire. And this is not a critic of that. I'm actually happy it is like this, that you can desire this object and take it home. But I wanted this show to be just different. Again, not because I don't like that people buy painting or that they are these objects of desire. Actually, I like that. But I wanted this show not to be like this, that when you enter, you should have the desire, oh, I wonder, could I have this painting? And it's not on the wall, so it is actually an object. It is something that you can tear apart and take down, but you very quickly notice that you can't take them out.
Right.
Plus, the only thing you can take here is free. It's a newspaper, and everybody can take the newspaper. So you have actually made, you're created like an equal stage there.
Right, just to be clear, the because of their situation, you know, Tal's dealers don't get to sell these paintings. They're not gonna be able to function in that marketplace. And again, there's no critique here that it just was another opportunity for doing something with the work that I think, don't
I think even, even a painting that you buy and you go home, take home, could have a critique inside itself.
Absolutely, yeah.
It's, yeah, go on.
No, I want to also ask you about the video.
Oh, yeah. Hmm? Doing, like inviting people, no, how to say it. When you do a show and you create a room like that, or if you do a painting, it's very much about counting, like putting just the right elements there that you feel people, they get like this, bam, when they leave. They go like dizzy out of there. Usually, and especially when you are younger, you place too much information because you just like this. You want to be sure. It's like people are coming over for dinner and you make Chinese food, Indian food, and American and Danish food. So there is for sure something that people are going to leave with. When you get a little bit more calmed down, you try to work to place exactly the amount of information. And since I had to imagine this show, I thought there's, first of all, out of the seven big works, there is a fabric piece. Because I needed, I talked to some people before here, and I gave a quite odd comparison. When you drive around here and you see all the abandoned houses, when you're an outsider, you don't know anything, you just wonder, when did this happen? And there's no clock there, because none of us really knows how long time it takes before a house collapses, really. But then suddenly there is a tree outside that is like 3 meters tall. Then you start having a clock. You understand how long time does it actually take for a tree to grow exactly in front of the stairs. Then there is a clock. As an artist, you work with similar things. You walk around, oh, he did these paintings and they're done here. And then suddenly there's a fabric piece that has a different timing in them, different tactile feeling. And I think that's important. That's like you make another kind of step in there. So you asked about the video. That's the third thing. I was looking for an element that did something else here, that brought you a bit out of here. So I filmed, together with my girlfriend, a video of a lamp that looks like the moon. Just very simple, very ambient, not a lot of information. It's just like you go into a show and there should be a moon, something that suddenly you focus on, although it's just down there. It's simply in the process of accounting in a show to make the show happen in people's eyes. Also the music, because that makes people want to go behind the wall there. And I think actually the video gives the least information of all of the works, and that's on purpose. It should be like that. Although it's moving images that should be kind of even more easy to read than a painting, it's saying almost nothing. It's just a lamp that looks like the moon and this weird playful melody that makes you dizzy.
Yeah. We found out last night that Tal and I are on the same plane back to Chicago at 5:12. And then he's going on to Copenhagen. So I think maybe we want to have, is it possible to ask, if anyone has questions? Alicia, is that okay? Yeah, so I don't know if anyone has questions. There's a mic, so, or comments or, you know, complaints.
Yeah, hello, thank you for the presentation. In the newspaper, I enjoyed reading the travelogue or whatever it is of the Yemen Cafe. Could you tell us who authored that that article?
Who wrote the story?
I wrote the story.
Well, you did.
When I came here, a friend here from the museum took me out for lunch, and I was still kind of jet-lagged. So I'm in Detroit that I know very little of, but I'm in a Yemen cafe. And I'm sitting there, and you get this kind of feeling that you can get in a modern world, that you're eating this Arabic food, and on the television, they just killed the former president, and it was going in a loop. And you sat there getting seasick. Where am I? You know, I know I'm not only in my brain and dreams, I'm actually in some real place. But if you start cutting up what real sometime is, it's more like a dream. And we were having this conversation that the president, the former president, he didn't seem, what actually killed him? He had no wounds, but they keep carrying on to this truck. And nothing really happened because there were not coming more information out on this Arabic news station. It was just him being carried onto the truck, and we got these huge pieces of bread, and you're sitting there. I think everyone knows it. It's not just jet lag, it's double, triple jet lag, cultural jet lag. And you think, maybe I'm just going to collapse now with all this information. When I went back, I said, okay, I'm going to try something I've never done. I never write anything. I'm very insecure in that. And to be honest, I was quite insecure with this text. Then I went to Haiti to make it even more dizzy. And I put up this test. Every day I'm going to write characters in that I somehow thought about that day or other people talked about. So it's a method. If I suddenly remember Miss Katz, a former teacher, I would just put her into this context and I would imagine her husband. And so actually all of these people in this text are real people. They're just as displaced as I felt when I was sitting there. And it's not something I feel in my high tower of being an artist. And we all know this feeling. You are suddenly, you take a plane and you are in London and you are on a bus and you say, where am I actually, you know? Where am I actually right now? Mm-hmm. And you get dizzy. This text is about that. And I just told Tara before that my fantasy is that, let's say Helsinki in Finland, they asked me to do a show to take exactly the same text and just change Cafe Yemen to some other cafe there, but we did exactly the same things to see what will happen if you just take this story and just change the names and put it there.
Right, and my response to that was that the text really does structurally, materially function the same way Tal makes his paintings. That he's nothing if not consistent. And again, that's to me another sign. I had the good fortune many years ago. I worked for Roy Lichtenstein for a few years, and considering the source, Roy said to me once, when you're an artist, you're lucky to get one good idea. And I was like, yeah, well, Roy, you got a pretty good one. This idea of consistency is everything. So when I read it this morning, it was put together like the paintings are put together. Anyway,
Hi, I really like the show. Congratulations for that. So my question is, when you choose a place, is it only the space or the history or the culture of that particular space? Because for me, I'm also not from here, not from this country at all. So this is a new place for me, and I have no idea what Detroit is, or I know very little. So seeing your work is very refreshing, and it gives me a different perspective. But when I see any space, it's more about the culture, and I mean, that's the main focus for me to determine or differentiate a space. So for your work, what is the main inspiration?
I often think that I want to speak about things that are quite simple. What does it mean? It means that they exist in most cultures. Of course, you can find certain cultures where a train doesn't exist. So when I paint a train, I bend the train towards something that I am interested in. I bend it. It's not just an ordinary train, it has details. But this train will mean something different here than in Europe. So I think as an artist, and this that I'm going to say now is my very subjective idea. When you want to talk about things, anything, I talk about things when I do a show like this. I really talk about all different things. There's two places you can be when you want to stand up and open your mouth. You can either really know about stuff. If I really know about Detroit, the deep history, I've lived here, I know people, I'm actually worthy of standing up and saying it is like this. But there's one other place you can be that is actually just as good as being in having deep knowledge. That's being really on the surface. Because on the surface, you're a little bit like getting things like a bird that goes for silver stuff. You actually sense stuff without the depth. It's actually really good to be there. And I know I decided to be on the surface. The worst thing is in the middle, when you start knowing. Because then you start being just half clever, and that's terrible. You either want to be to really know in depth, or you want to be on the surface. And I definitely, my images, all these things that I work with day and night, I'm in depth with that. But when I reach out for something, I'm on the surface. I know I have to be there. Anything else will make me mediocre.
Yeah. And I'll say Tal is so smart to stay there, because then you have someone like me who this morning made the mistake of okay, I'll Google black bottom just to see what pops up. And so I did find out a little interesting tidbit that, of course, that name has to do with what the French colonial settlers called that neighborhood relative to the soil. But of course, how that resonates now in relation to today, and that neighborhood being, the other thing that the internet says is that neighborhood was that neighborhood stopped existing by the 1960s.
That's totally
in that awful place that Tal does not need to be, but I, in a moment of weakness, threw myself into it this morning. But what do I do with that? The Fort Wayne stuff resonates for me, because to be talking to, again, we could go on and on with Tal about, Tal and I've talked often over the years about being this kid born in Israel and then shipped off to Denmark as a very small child, and Scandinavia, and that you know, it's like your story does resonate for you to be built the way you've ended up being built and for you to do the work the way you're doing your work. I mean, that does all make sense. But if that's all it was, or if you really like just let that be, it would be pretty boring. You know, if just that you sort of leave that to one side and then you sort of let yourself be led around by your nose in the studio, in the painting, and what the paintings themselves do, the paintings as kind of machines, I guess, that sort of produce something for themselves. That's why, and I can attest to, you know, when I finally got Tal to come, you know, Tal had been on the list for students of like the top, wanting him to come. You know, your work resonates on so many levels with so many people for good reason, but it's ultimately because it's, you know, what it's doing in painting, I think. Is there any other question? Here, go ahead.
Hello. What do you mean when you say to students that they're too earnest?
Oh, God, I knew this was going to happen.
I'm really curious. And then also, can you explain a bit about Tal R's talk about the irresponsible as the prince of death?
I think watch Google said. SAIC Tal R and watch his talk. Because we're running out of time, that'll be the easy thing for the irresponsible thing. He covers that territory and then some. Right, Aviv? Aviv is a current student at SAIC who's graduating on Monday with her MFA. Her father's here from Israel. But it was a great talk, right? Yeah, so, and you can totally watch that. I knew this was going to happen. I don't know. I just think, like, well, let me put it another way. When I teach very young students, like freshmen, sophomore, just getting into art school, I say my only job at that point is to change your word art from starting with a capital A to a lowercase a. That, like, there's this fear, this kind of the thing that a young student's most scared of, that some professor, something, or even worse yet, another student will say, that's not art. You know, like, they're so caught up in having to make sure it's sending all the bells and whistles. And earnestness is the thing that often contributes to that. You just got to get over it. I just showed Tal a great clip of one of my heroes, Kenny Shopson, who had an amazing restaurant in New York. If you Google Kenny Shopson, and it's the clip from the is just about, you know, basically we're all pieces of shit. You know, and if you learn that and you accept that, when you occasionally do the right thing, you know, you can feel good about that. But people who claim they're good all the time, they're not so good. You know, like that. So I just think that ultimately, you know, that's a healthy, and I think, you know, when you get old, when I was in my 20s, someone said that to me, I'd be like, F you, you know, like, you know, I'm, you know, but I think, you know, and, you know, I think you liked that clip, right? You thought that it was a pretty healthy way to be in the world, that you occasionally do something good and, you know, but you don't, it's not your job to, like, be responsible at this. It's not your job to...
I think honesty in a relationship with people is not the same honesty in art. It's something completely different. So, again, bringing back to something we talked about earlier, I'll do anything to let the painting happen. I'll be very irresponsible, dishonest, without moral to let this happen. But that's not the same as with people. That's a different situation. So you have to understand this in the process of making artworks.
Yeah, Tal, in that talk in Chicago, he said, I'm paraphrasing here, that I send my paintings out in ways I would never send my child out, you know, into the world. You know, and I think that, in a nutshell, sort of is it. That, like, the painting's got to live on its own. Painting, you know, Tal makes pretty tough paintings. I mean, I've written about it, like Larry Pittman, someone I've talked about, his paintings are bulletproof. And this is a man who literally took a bullet in the 80s and almost died. That, like, you know, you go into the DIA, and, you know, like, the paintings that really still resonate are the ones that, you know, they're really damn tough. They can hold their own. They exist in different contexts. You know, there's this thing Charlie Ray, the sculptor, talks about what he calls the fire hose of history. And he says the first thing the fire hose of history does is it blasts meaning off of art objects constantly. So if you're, and earnestness often means you're really caught up in meaning. I know what my work means, and I'm going to tell you what it means and all that. And, you know, you just can go into the museum here or the Art Institute anywhere, and you're faced with objects from all periods where that meaning has been obliterated, added again, warped, changed, messed with, deliberately lied about, you know, stolen, you know, the list goes on and on and on. So why should any of us have the arrogance to think that what we're doing right now is somehow different? It's not. You know, it is what it is. That doesn't devalue it. It actually heightens the value. It actually, in my opinion, and I think Tal would agree with this, it makes it all the more meaningful that you can get to that place in the work. But that takes time. It doesn't happen overnight. And I think knowing Tal's history, it didn't happen overnight for him either. Although you had, the seed was there. Great. Thank you all very much. Thanks everyone here at MOCAD. This is a great place. It's my first time here. It's a really great place. I'm thrilled that you brought Tal, and thank you all for braving the arrival. It looks like maybe the rain has stopped. Hope springs eternal. Thank you again.